Do not be afraid. You seek Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. There is a story told from the 1960s. Everyone knows the name of Thomas Merton, the Cistercian from Gethsemane Abbey. Merton was one of these kind of avant-garde. He was a great thinker, profound soul, beautiful writings. Tormented soul, that's a whole other sermon. But in the 50s and the 60s, he kind of hooked onto the beatniks, and he hooked onto Zen, and he hooked onto Tibetan Buddhism. And in the better sense, he dialogued with them. Some of it was probably confusion for him personally, but again, that's another sermon. But with the brilliance of Thomas Merton's mind, on the good side, he discussed religious notions with these non-Christians. And when he came to the Tibetan Buddhists, it was actually kind of humorous. Because they didn't understand this idea of Jesus rising from the dead. And one of the monks said to them once, "We don't understand this because when our dead rise, we do spells and things to make them lay down again." And because, of course, what the Buddhists were thinking was that our Lord just walked out of the tomb back into the life that he had had before. He rose from the dead. Like Lazarus was brought back from the dead. Lazarus rose from the dead. But Lazarus died again later on, as would have done the young man of Nain, the daughter of Jairus, and these other resurrections that we're told of in the Gospel. And what Merton wound up telling the Tibetan Buddhists at that time, they said, "Oh no, but that's not the idea of the resurrection. The resurrection is the movement of our Lord into the transformation of being into the light and the glory of existence, of this transformation." At that point, the Buddhists then understood what it meant. Because it was not the question of just coming back from the dead. It was the question of a transformation of existence to a life of glory. Now, that didn't make them Christians, but at least they understood why this was central to the Christian religion. And I give the example because there's far too many, even among Christians, who think of the resurrection as Jesus just walked out of the tomb, and now he's alive again, and one day he sails off to the heavens. That's the ascension. And this is weird, to say the least. What our Lord does is a return that this new moment that takes place on this day 2,000 years ago is an entire new creation which begins. That the paradise which God established in the beginning, which was order and harmony and beauty and justice and grace, that when the human race decided that that was insufficient, and we can do it better, that sin of our origin, which affects all of us individually to this day, of course, was a screw-up. They didn't make the order of beauty and grace and harmony that was originally created better. We just have to look around us to know that the world is not in that beautiful order. So that what we're doing here on this day, with all these women that come, why don't I encourage you, as I always do, read the scriptures this week. Go back and read the ends of the Gospels. It's easy to find them. Just go to the end of it. It's the end of the story. And when you read it, each of the four Gospels are profoundly different. Because what is taking place is our Lord's manifestation, his resurrection. He is physical. When he first appears to the apostles, they think he's a ghost. So they say, "Well, give me something to eat. I will eat with you, and you'll see I'm flesh and blood." And yet it's flesh and blood which is profoundly transformed. Our Lord passes through closed doors. Gospels, you'll see this kind of confusion of the stories. Because our Lord is here in the garden, and then he's here in Emmaus a few miles away. Then he's in Galilee. Then he's back in Jerusalem. Then he's in Jerusalem in the evening. He's here and here and here and here. And the Gospels record these stories of our Lord appearing to different people. Because whereas our Lord is physical, he is in his human nature, resurrected from the dead, it is a human nature which has been renewed and transformed. What we celebrate on the resurrection is a new creation. This is a cosmic event which takes place of God incarnate, to which we are invited to enter by faith and by baptism. And that grace that transforms us is precisely what we see here and there. When our Lord meets the first women, they find nothing in the tomb. They leave, they go away. Then our Lord appears to them. They fall on the ground. They're overwhelmed by seeing him. And they do what you'd expect them to do. They fall on the ground. They grab him around his knees and hug him. But our Lord is trying to elevate them to understand that what has happened is not just that he's back. This is a transformation of something very profound, of the entire human race in principle, in its origin, in the reason why our Lord is called the new Adam. As the old Adam was the origin of all of the human race that descends from him, and we know this even by the science of genetics, that there is one man and one woman, the same reason our Lord then, in the transformation of his human nature on this day, he becomes the fountainhead and the source of an entirely new created human race. When St. Paul writes about the human race on earth, he breaks them into three races, in fact. The people of Israel, because of the law of Mount Sinai. The pagans, who only have the law of nature, do the best they can with their wits. And that third race, which is Christians. He breaks humanity up into these three. But of course, for St. Paul, as he writes, he reminds us that the Christianity is meant to spread to the entire human race and encompass it in this new creation. So when these women come to the tomb, and we're told in this gospel today that you have in your bulletin, that when they leave, they're trembling. They come to find a body to finish doing the devotion of burying our Lord. And not only do they not find the body, they find this enormous stone that's taller than a man that's been rolled back. And then they find somebody in there. And who points out, telling them that now he's risen from the dead. And when they leave, the English translation that we have, we're told, is that they tremble and their fear seizes them. In the Greek of the Gospel, the term that's literally there is ekstasis, our word ecstasy, but not in this kind of vulgar sense that we have today in English. Ekstasis literally means, stasis is to stand. Ek in Greek is outside. Ekstasis literally means that they are standing outside of themselves. They are overwhelmed by what has taken place at this dawn. When our Lord appears to Mary Magdalene, and as you read the Gospels, they will tell you, she thinks he's the gardener. St. Ephrem will spin an entire series of poems around this idea of our Lord being the gardener, because in fact, through this new creation, he is the new gardener. He reestablishes a paradox through this new creation to introduce this renewed humanity. Which is why, when he appears to Mary Magdalene, she doesn't recognize him, as you said. She thinks he's a gardener, and when she recognizes him finally and falls down to do the same thing that the other women had done, to grab him around the knees in this act of love, he pushes her back. Pushes her back because there is something more that he wants her to learn. The other women he allows. But Mary Magdalene is to be taken further in the understanding of grace and this new creation. So what I want to leave you with is that every morning in Safra, our morning office, we address our Lord as the radiant day, capital R, capital D, the radiant day and the source of all light. This finds its origin, this title, the radiant day, in this new creation which takes place. That when you read the gospel again that you have in the bulletin, it has a phrase that says, on the first day of the week, that's when the women go out. But that's not actually what the gospel says in itself. It talks about on the first of the Sabbath. This is the term which is actually there. Be'ehad ba'shabbaton. Shabbaton is the term which is used literally from Sabbath, referring to the entire week. Ehad just means one. So that when the gospel is being written in Greek, it uses the term mia, the first. It doesn't say first day. On the one of the rest of Sabbath, these women go at dawn, the rising of the sun, to this tomb. Now, none of this may make any big difference to any of you. But the reason why I bring it up is what the gospel is pointing out is that this is the beginning of something new. Be'ehad. This is a first rising of the sun. This is a new, which is why next Sunday we call New Sunday. And we'll develop this idea of why we call the octave day of Easter a New Sunday. But it's already contained in this gospel of the firsts in the Sabbath, which is literally the term being translated into Greek. But this is an entire new creation following the rest, Shabbat, of the old creation. All of that in the period of forwards. I have great faith that you have profound minds and are able to bring all of this in. So we leave you, I will wave my arms around for the end of the sermon because it makes it easier. What we wind up seeing here then is that what takes place in the work of redemption is that God, the eternal hidden one, Alo Genizo, the hidden God, appears in time born in Bethlehem to Mary of Nazareth. We all like Christmas. Everyone likes a baby. But it's not about the baby. It's about the manifestation of the hidden one in time and place. And that as he embraces this human nature and lives through his life of Nazareth and then teaches for 3 years, he embraces all of that failure, shortcomings, illness, everything else that comes by that bad choice of our original parents in paradise. He embraces all, including the significant sign of death. He embraces death willfully. It is not due to him, he is sinless. But he embraces death and he marches towards Jerusalem. And he allows this arrest, this humiliation, this betrayal by Judas and the others. And his crucifixion and death, which is why at the moment of death he says, it is all consummated, it is finished. He embraces death. Death and that human nature, being consumed by death, death itself is consumed by our Lord's divinity. He enters into the place of the dead, that's Friday night and Saturday. It's what we say in the creed, we believe in the descent into hell. That's a whole other sermon. And that our Lord rises in a new creation. He has destroyed death, recreated human nature in this new creation, so that in that glory of physicality but of transformation, he invites each of us individually to enter into this sublime light, a radiant day and source of all light. This is the gift being offered to us. So enjoy your peeps this afternoon. Have fun with your egg fights. But remember that what we celebrate profoundly here is that each one of us personally has been and is invited through faith, grace, baptism, not just simply to believe, but to be transformed anew into that transformation of life, which is not something that happens later on. It begins here, now, today, this transformation. And it's because the transformation begins here that when we die, death has been changed not from something permanent, but to a mere transit point to the kingdom of light in eternity. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,